everyone. Welcome back to Book Banter from the Public Library of Youngstown in Mahoning County. I'm Sarah, here with Cindy today. And again, we've read the same book. This time, we read All the Stars and Teeth by Adeline Grace. Now, this one is a fantasy that is set in the fictional world of Visidia, a kingdom of islands where each island's inhabitants have a different form of magic. Amora is the princess and heir to the throne, and she is also set to become the High Animancer, which is the practitioner of soul magic. And the royal family is the only one who has this magic. But in order to do that, she has to demonstrate mastery of soul magic, and it goes horribly wrong. So now she's on the run with a mysterious pirate whose magic has been stolen from him, and they're traveling around the kingdom trying to save themselves and the kingdom, which is now under threat from a villain that her father didn't believe in. So there's also some truths about the past in her family that Amora is going to have to face as well. So, Cindy, are you ready to do this?
I'm ready.
All right, so we'll do thumbs up, thumbs meh, or thumbs down. So 3, 2, 1. Yeah, I was very meh about this book.
Me too. I really wanted to like it. It got so much buzz. I mean, they were saying the YA book to look forward to, you know, automatic bestseller, and everyone was so excited, so I was ready. I was ready, but
yeah. I know, and I was excited for this because you were excited for it, and you know, usually you don't steer me wrong, but yeah, and the cover is absolutely beautiful. Oh my goodness. And I don't know, I just felt like there really wasn't anything new here. We've kind of seen a lot of this before. We've seen the mysterious handsome pirate. You know, we've seen the arranged marriage that's one-sided in feeling. You know, there was just not a whole lot of new things here.
Right. I didn't do thumbs down because she does do really well with some things.
The action and the fighting scenes were very, very good.
Yeah, she does very well with the whole adventure part, and she really knows how to ratchet up intensity, the fight scenes and fighting with the sea monster, all of that. She's very, very good at. But I felt like it just needed a little more polish. I don't know. She was telling a lot. We were in Amora's head way, way too much. Would have liked her to show me more instead of tell me so much.
Right. One of the things that I actually put down is I would have liked to have seen more of the other island's magics. Yes. You know, of course, this is told from Amora's point of view, so we get a lot of the soul magic. And her betrothed is a healer, so we get a lot of that magic, too, and how it works and what can and can't be done. But we really don't get anything else. And because there is a sequel coming out, so maybe it's there. But I really would have liked more about how each one works and the limits on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she didn't develop it enough. There was even the characters, and they were great. I know. I loved Ferrick. I did. I loved the mermaid. The mermaid is wonderful.
Batea, yes, I love her.
But there wasn't enough of them. I didn't feel like I knew them at the end. You know, you kind of, okay, they're in there together. It's a great crew. I think she's developed that well. But the people themselves, I didn't feel like I knew them well enough.
Well, I feel like we knew Amora. But yeah, some of the other back characters or the side characters, really there could have been more done with them. I definitely loved Batea, and I wanted more Batea and the mermaid and the history of the mermaids and the lore and everything. I loved that.
You can do a whole mermaid book. I would love a book on the mermaid. Definitely.
Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, they're just, I don't know. She was the only character that I really found myself rooting for and was excited when she was in a scene.
Yeah. Like I said, we spent way too much time in Amora's head. The whole first half of the book was I just felt like I was in an Amora encyclopedia, and I wanted out a little bit. And she, though she's heroic and determined and you know, adventurous, she's also a little
whiny.
She's also a little whiny, and the romance, okay, she's in love with the pirate, but who's not quite piratey enough for me. I mean, I was all in for the whole swashbuckling on the sea kind of thing. Mm-hmm. Just didn't quite make that. I just felt like it could have been developed quite a bit more. And I know it's fantasy, and we got to take some time and world build, and especially when you have such a complex magic system that she's working with, which was interesting. I mean, that was good. There's a lot of good parts. There really is. But I just felt like she could go a lot deeper. Now,
right. And yeah, I found my
theology.
Yeah, so. I found myself comparing this to like Children of Blood and Bone, because Naomi Adeyemi did the blurb for the cover, and so I found myself kind of comparing those two without even meaning to, because I felt like in Children of Blood and Bone that even though you're getting it from just a couple of points of view, and they have different magics, I still felt familiar enough with the other magics in that book. Whereas, like I said, this one, it just wasn't there. Like, there's a character who starts practicing a magic that she shouldn't, and it's like, well, how did that come to be? You know, yeah. Like, yeah. If she wasn't on that island, how did that happen? I just wanted more. I needed more story and less brooding.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. The ending, near the ending where all that's explained with the how the soul magic began, mm-hmm. whole political part of how the kingdom is set up, and they're on their own separate islands, which sounds great in the beginning. So she did well with that too, the whole political intrigue kind of thing.
And that scene in particular where Amora discovers the truth. Mm-hmm. That was actually probably like my favorite part of the book. It was, yeah. That was the part I couldn't put down.
Mm-hmm.
Just yeah. Learning, I mean, getting that more that I wanted through the whole book, just getting all of that. That is where I was just like, yes, I just need the other 200 and something pages to be like this.
Yeah.
That one was yeah. really well done. And I was not mad at all about how everything came to be and whatnot.
Yeah, and that part even was a little too short.
Mm-hmm.
And, it did kind of fill things in for you, and it was the least predictable about piece of the book. So, I mean, that's probably why we loved it so much, but she just needed to go more with everything. And with it being a duology, I'm just kind of worried how much she's going to be able to pick up with this.
Yeah.
It is her first book. It's a debut. I mean, it is,
and it's not a bad debut.
I want to say good things because there are really good things there, but I don't know if I'll rush to pick up the second book though.
Yeah. Same. This is by no means a bad book. It's just, mm-mm. You know, I like my fantasies to be epic and sweeping and world building. And that's mm-hmm. just not what I got with this book. And so I was a little bit disappointed, but it is by no means a bad book.
Oh no.
It is still good. It's just not my cup of tea.
Yeah. Yeah. And fantasy, I really like fantasy. It's not the genre. It's just the lack of development and the romance. She just met this pirate. Okay. So it got really deep, really fast. I don't know. I was just kind of disappointed. Maybe that's part of it. Maybe because the buzz was so huge and everyone was, she has some big names that wrote for her as far as reviews. So maybe mm-hmm. that's it. Maybe it's a disappointment thing for me. And maybe that's why I don't know. But I did like the darker aspect of it. You don't see that a lot in YA. She went a little darker than...
She did, like when she's describing the family crown that they wear, like, oh my gosh, like that was just like, it was mind blowing to me, just that little part. And then trying to envision people wearing this elaborate crown. And this is, again, not a spoiler because you learn about it, I think, in the first 25 pages. But it's made out of a skeleton, of an animal skeleton.
Yeah.
And, I mean, and then they basically just bejewel it. And it was just like, that was really cool. That was another thing that I really liked. And yeah.
That's what I mean. She does so something so well. I just wanted her to keep at that with it.
Yeah.
Because the whole aspect of her proving that she's ready for this kingdom by performing this very serious, intense, strange, dark magic was like, whoa, we haven't seen that before.
Right.
Maybe we can kind of pieces, okay, everybody has their own little flavor of magic, but there are original things here and wonderful characters. I mean, I was already into the whole, yes, we're part of the crew. I mean, I got that, I felt that, but it's like, okay, I need to know this a little bit more about that mermaid.
I know.
I hope she does. I hope she, you know, does a spinoff and does a book with
her. I'll be honest. If there's alternating points of view in the next one, there's not in this one, but if the next one is alternating points of view and one of them's Vitea, I will probably pick it up so much sooner.
You and I both. And then we'll talk about it.
Yeah. We'll do it again. So again, we read All the Stars and Teeth by Adeline Grace. It is available for curbside pickup, and it is also available as an ebook on Overdrive. So thanks for joining us this week, and we will see y'all next week. Bye.
Bye-bye.